Shalom, friends. Welcome to another shiur in Talmud's Am Eliyahu shiur from Chesed Ve'emet. You can find my site on www.lovingkindness.co. I'm very grateful today to share this shiur with everybody, as it is also being donated. This shiur is being sponsored in memory Le'iloi Nishmas. It's being sponsored anonymously. Le'iloi Nishmas, in memory of Hitzla Ayeles Bas Yehuda Uri HaKohen. So we're learning Masechet Brachot, tractate blessings. It is a tractate all about beautiful blessings. All the teachings are filled with brachot, of blessings. The teachings tell us so much about life itself. We're currently on page Zion, Amud Beis, right at the very bottom. In fact, we completed it last week, but I'm just going to go over that end point just so that we can have somewhere to go from that point onwards. And then we'll move on to Daf Chet Amud Aleph, page 8, side A. So we're reading over here on the left-hand side. We're using the Koren Talmud Bavli, as you can see in front of you, a very beautiful edition where you can clearly see the Talmud as it's written in the text itself. You can see in translation and explanation, and on the side you can also see the notes and pictures and so on. It really makes the learning easy and beautiful and a pleasure to learn with. So we're starting over here. Omale Rabbi Yitzhak le Rav Nachman. Rabbi Yitzhak said to Rav Nachman, "My timer lo ase mar levei knishta. What is the reason that the master did not come to the shul letzaluyei to daven?" The story goes that Rav Nachman did not come to shul one day to pray. And of course, there's a mitzvah to daven in shul. So Rav Yitzhak says, "Why didn't you come to shul to daven?" Omalei, he responded, Rav Nachman responded to Rabbi Yitzhak. He says, "Lo yachilna. I'm very sorry, I wasn't able to attend." Omalei, so Rav Yitzhak said back to Rav Nachman, "Well, in that case, if you weren't able to come, you know what you should have done? You should have gathered to yourself 10 people, and then you should have prayed, at least with a minyan, wherever you happen to be." Omalei, so he responded, Rav Nachman said back to Rabbi Yitzchak, "Tricheli milta, this thing is quite a bit of a burden to me. If I've got to gather 10 people to pray in my home, it's going to be quite a bit of a burden to get these people together." So he says, "Velei malei mar lishrucha ditzibura." So he answered him back and he said, "You know what? Maybe the master should have sent to the shlucha ditzibura, to the shaliach tibur, to the chazan of the shul, the representative who's going to pray for the community. He should have sent for him and he should have asked him, 'Do me a favor. Beyidana demitzalei ditzibura, leisei velodei lemar.' At the time that the community is praying, let him come and notify the master," which means to say, when the community is praying, "please let me know, and then I will pray at the same time that the community is praying. And so to speak, by doing so, we will be praying at the same time." So he said here, "Why did the master not come to the synagogue? One must strive to pray with the community in synagogue. If one cannot pray in the synagogue, he should at least try to pray at the time the community prays. Those who live in small cities where there is no prayer quorum must arrange for their prayer to coincide with the time when those in the nearest city are praying." And we see that's the halakha lemaisa, as you brought it down last week, especially during this time of the coronavirus. If a person finds himself unable to attend to daven in the shul, perhaps the government have restricted it, the rabbis have restricted it. In your community, everybody knows what the best thing is to do at this point in time. I think that the majority of the rabbis are holding that, although if you can have a minyan, you still have to keep your distance from each other and you have to wear masks. And of course, if it's difficult for a person to be in such a situation, or he's an elderly person who has to worry and be more concerned about his health, everybody has to be concerned about their health. Or if he's just worried about his health altogether, he might be a weak person. He should daven at home. Well, when he davens at home, at a minimum, if he can, he should try to know the time that the community is praying and to pray at that point in time. For example, if mincha is at 5:30 in the shul in the afternoon, then he should at 5:30 pray mincha at home. Don't pray at 3:00. pray at 5:30 at the same time that the community prays. And in that way, he really also takes a part in davening with the community. Amalei, so Rav Nachman answered back to Rabbi Yitzhak, you have a lot of questions going on. My kulehai, what's this all about? What are you getting on? What are you getting so excited about here? Amalei, he said to him, because we were learning already about all the teachings of Rabbi Yochanan, who was teaching these teachings in the name of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. And in this particular instance, he taught the following teaching about prayer. The Gemara asked the question, what is written? That's the phrase that the Gemara uses to question something that's found in the Tanakh, and then to give an explanation of what the verse means. What is written in the Torah, where it says, meaning in the Tanakh, and in this case, we're referring to the book of Tehillim, in the book of Psalms. The pasuk that King David says is the following, V'ani tefilasi lecha Hashem eis ratzon. And as for me, my prayer to you, Hashem, is at an eight ratzon, a favorable time. For those people who have been part of communities where many times the rabbi is giving a drasha, and he says in his drasha, you know, friends, at the moment, it's called an eis ratzon. It is called a time of divine favor. When it is a time of divine favor, it means it is more likely that one's prayer will be answered. Now, times of divine favor can be anything. It can be anything from the idea of a particular time of the day, a particular period in the calendar, a particular event that is happening. All of these times are considered eight ratzon, a time of divine favor. And when one finds oneself in such a position and in such a place where one knows that it is a time of divine favor and one prays at that point in time, it is more likely that one's prayer will be answered. Not that one's prayer won't be answered at any other time, but what we want to always do is if we know that it is a special time to pray, that God is more favorable to us, then of course we should pray at that particular time and with even more kavanah. So King David says that as for me, with regards to my prayer, to you, Hashem, at a time of divine favor, asks the Gemara, Eimasai Eis Ratzon. Well, when is this period of time of divine favor? Because King David is saying over here, as for my prayer to you, Hashem, it will be at a time of divine favor. When is this time of divine favor? Answers the Gemara, B'sha'ashi atzibur mitpalalin, at the time that the community pray. When the community are involved in prayer, that is called a time of divine favor, which means to say that when one prays, therefore, at the same time as the community are praying, then it is a special time to have one's prayers answered. And therefore, we see how important it is to daven with the community at that point in time. Here, the note says on the side over here that the Gemara's objective here is not to prove that communal prayer is greater and more readily accepted than individual prayer, as that is obvious from many other Talmudic statements. Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai teaches that beyond participation in communal prayer, it is beneficial for an individual to join the congregation at the time when they are praying, even if he does not actually participate in prayer with them. Listen to that beautiful idea. In addition to actually praying with them, even when the community is just involved in the idea of prayer and the person is sitting on the sideline and he's not even praying himself, nevertheless, this is also a time of divine favor. And therefore, when he even sits there and he just takes part in whatever small prayer he has or whatever it is, that is a time of divine favor. This idea is supported by the verses that are quoted. But as for me, let my prayer be unto you, Lord, apparently refers to an individual praying in a time of favor, i.e. while the congregation is praying. Similarly, he has redeemed my soul in peace so that none came upon me. Refers to the acceptance of individual prayer, for there were many with me. So he's just giving us another interpretation of the idea of a time of divine favor, and that when the community are praying, at that point in time, it is a time of divine favor. Rabbi Yossi b'Rabbi Chanina Omar, Rabbi Yossi, the son of Chanina, said, Mehacha, you can also learn it out from here, meaning the importance of praying with the community. Ko amar Hashem, ba'eis ratzon anisecho. So says Hashem, at the time of favor, I shall answer you. Which means to say, when is that exactly? It says, in a time of acceptance, I've answered you on a day of salvation. I have aided you. This is another verse that is describing this idea. Rabbi Acha bar Rabbi Chanina Omar, Rabbi Acha, the son of Rabbi Chanina, said, Mehacha. Here's another verse that's coming to teach us the importance of davening together with the community. Hein El Kabir Velo Yimas. Behold, God is mighty. He despises no one. God is mighty. He despises no one. How do I learn from this that it's so important to daven with the community? Ukasiv, and it's written, Pada b'shalom nafshi mikarav li ki barabim hayu imadi. He has redeemed my soul in peace from those who he has redeemed my soul in peace so that none came upon me, because for there were many with me. What does it mean there were many with me? Because there were many with me, meaning during prayer, that is the time that God has redeemed me. So we see over here that this verse teaches that the prayer was answered because there were many with me when it was offered. Here we see the importance of therefore praying together with the community. And if one cannot pray with the community, then of course one can pray at the time that the community is praying, and that is also a very favorable time, an eis ratzon. Tanya nami hachi, it was also taught, he has another teaching in another brisa, Rabbi Nassan Omer, Rabbi Nassan says, Minayin she'en HaKadosh Baruch Hu mo'eis b'tefilasan shel rabim. From where do we know it from? That the Holy One, blessed be He, that He does not despise the prayer of the many. Which means to say, when a person prays by himself, he has only his own merits to go by if God is going to answer him. But when he prays with the community, it's the merits of the entire community that stand by him when he makes his prayer. So imagine, for example, the difference in the situation of 10 merits that a person has to his own name. And if he's davening with 10 people and each of them has 10 merits to themselves, and therefore there is a total of 100 merits, then when he prays, he has 100 merits that are surrounding him at that point in time. So how do we know that HaKadosh Baruch Hu does not despise the prayer of the many, which means it's very important to daven with the community? Shene'emar, because the pasuk says, Hein El Kabir V'lo Yimas. It says here that a mighty God, and he does not despise. But there's a different way of reading the verse. Instead of reading the verse that he's a mighty God, the other way that one can read it is to say that, behold, God does not despise the mighty. What does it mean? He doesn't despise the mighty. He doesn't despise when many people are involved in this effort of prayer. Ukasiv, and it is therefore written afterwards, Pada b'shalom nafshi mikravli. He redeemed in peace my soul from those, so nobody could come up against me. Omar HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, anybody who occupies himself in Torah study, in acts of kindness, and he davens with the community, that's what the verse says here. Pada b'shalom nafshi. He has redeemed my soul in peace. But whose soul are we talking about? We're talking about HaKadosh Baruch Hu, so to speak. I consider it about him as if he redeemed me, li, me, olevanai, and my children, libein umas ha'olam, from amongst the nations of the world. We see over here, anybody who occupies himself in the study of Torah, while we're doing it, like we're doing right now, we're studying Torah, and as a result of this, we are redeeming God. When we do an act of kindness, we give tzedakah, or we just help somebody, or any type of act that one can think of in terms of kindness. And likewise, when one davens together with the community, so it's as if one redeems God from amongst the nations of the world. He brings in goodness. So to speak, God is in exile. And how do we show that God is really not in exile, that he's really here with us, and he's not just somewhere? We don't know where he is. He's out of the world, so to speak, when you do the mitzvah. When we do the mitzvah, we point to the fact that God is there. It must be, because if we're involved in a mitzvah, we're showing the goodness of the creator of the world. When we go about our activities on our own and we end up doing things that we shouldn't do, at that point in time, so to speak, we kick the Shekhinah away from us and we place the Shekhinah, the divine, the dwelling of God's presence, so to speak, we put the divine dwelling into exile when we are involved in an Aveira, and when we're involved in a mitzvah, we show the whole world that at this place, at this point in time, God is present. And so therefore, when a person does one of these things, three things, the Torah study, the act of kindness, and davening together with the community, it's as if we redeemed God from amongst the nations of the world. Omar Reish Lakish. Reish Lakish said the following. Remember Reish Lakish, the brother-in-law of Rabbi Yochanan? Once upon a time, he was a bandit, and then afterwards, he became a great Torah scholar in the Chavrusa of Rabbi Yochanan and the brother-in-law as well. Call me sheyesh lo beit ha-knesset be'iro, says Reish Lakish. Anybody who has a shul in his city, ve'eno nichnas sham lihitpalel, and he doesn't enter into it, he doesn't go to the shul in order to daven. So he has a shul right nearby. He could easily go there. We're not talking about somebody who can't manage to get to shul. We're certainly not talking about somebody in the situation that we are at the moment with a virus, and perhaps we shouldn't go to shul. We're talking about a general idea. A person has a shul in his community. He has the ability to get to the shul easily, and he still doesn't go to daven in shul. Nikra shachen ra. He's called an evil neighbor. He's called a very bad neighbor. He's not taking part in the activities of the community, of all his neighbors. Shene'emar, how do we know this? Because the verse says, Ko omar Hashem. And Hashem said, I'll call shcheinai haraim, about all of my bad neighbors, hanoikim benachala, who are touching the inheritance or the heritage, which means to say, they are close to the Torah, they are close to the shul. Ashen chalti esami, that I have given over to my nation to inherit, et Yisrael, the Jewish people. So in other words, what happens is, who are the shcheinai haraim, the shcheinai haraim, who are all of these neighbors who are bad? These are the ones who are coming so close, they're right there by the shul, but they don't come into the shul. Because it says over here, I'll read the English over here, that as for all my evil neighbors who touch my inheritance, which I've caused my people in Israel to inherit, they come close, but they don't actually go into it. Behold, I will pluck them up from off their land, and will pluck the house of Judah up from among them. One who only touches, but does not enter the place of prayer, my inheritance is considered an evil neighbor. V'lo od, not only this. The person who does this is causing exile to himself and to his children. As the verse says, behold, I am plucking them from amongst the land. I will pluck them from off their land. And the house of Judah I will pluck out from among them. So we see over here again, this is the person who has a shul in the neighborhood, but he chooses not to go. It's as if he comes close to the nachala, as if he touches the inheritance, but he doesn't actually go in and make an effort to be a part of it. The inheritance is sitting there, and he didn't do anything about it. So this person is called a shachein ra, an evil neighbor. We read the notes on the side. Anyone who engages in Torah study and in acts of kindness and praise with the congregation. These three elements are the foundation of the world. As it is taught in the Mishnah in Tractate Avot, this is the second Mishnah. In the first chapter of Pirkei Avot, it says, on three things the world stands: on the Torah, on the temple service, and on acts of loving kindness. These are the three pillars that the world was really built upon. And the world is established upon, which means that the entire creation exists upon these three pillars. If you drop one of these pillars, the world is going to fall apart. Today, the temple is no longer standing, and consequently, there is no temple service. Communal prayer stands in its stead, inasmuch as the daily prayers mirror the sacrificial service, says the Maharsha. So therefore, we see over here, al shlosha dvarim ha'olam omed, al ha'teira, v'al ha'avoida, v'al gemilos chasadim. These are the three pillars upon which the world stands. Without these three pillars, we have nothing in the world. Torah, acts of loving kindness, and tefillah, davening. One who has a synagogue in his city, but does not enter to pray there. One who has a synagogue in his city, but he does not go there to pray, is called an evil neighbor. and causes exile for himself and his offspring, says the Rambam, brought down in Halakha and the Shulchan Aruch, as we see over there. Amaru le Rabbi Yochanan, they said to Rabbi Yochanan, Ika Save Bavavil, a new story. They were talking to Rabbi Yochanan, and they said to him, you know that there are elders who live in Bavel. Happened to be telling a story. They said there's some old people who live in Bavel. Tama v'omar. He was amazed, taken aback. And he said, Leman yirbu yameichem v'meivaneichem al ha'adama. In order that your days shall increase and the days of your children upon the land. What does that mean to say? When we do all these mitzvot as we're supposed to do, then our days will be increased upon the land. Which means upon where? Upon the land of Israel, of course. Ala adama, on the land. Kasev, it's written, aval b'chutzel la'aret. But when we talk about outside the land, which means in the diaspora, lo, no such thing exists. The days are only increased. You can only have long life when we're fulfilling the mitzvahs in the land of Israel. That is what's known as Aretz, the land. Kevanda Amri Lei. So he said it can't be. According to Rabbi Yochanan, it can't be that there are elders in Bavel. Doesn't make any sense to me. Because in Bavel, there's no reason why anything that they do should result in long life. Because the reward of long life is for people who do the mitzvahs in Eretz Yisrael. So how do we understand it? Kevanda Amri Lei, since they said to him the following, they answered and they said, Rabbi Yochanan, Makdami Umakshechi Leveknishta. Those sages, these old people who are in Bavel, they go to shul early in the morning and later at the evening time. They go to shul. Makdami Umakshechi Leveknishta. They go early and late to the Beit Knesset. Omar, so Rabbi Yochanan said, Hayinu ta'ahani lehu. This is what it is that has helped them. You want to know what gave these people to have old age? It is because they went to shul early in the morning and later on in the evening again. They were at shul in the morning and at shul at the nighttime also. That's what brings long life. Anybody wants to know to do something that can add to a person's long life? Of course, one can eat healthily and one can have all sorts of recipes as to what brings a person long life. Well, this Gemara teaches us that one of the things that we can do to bring long life is to daven in the shul in the morning for shacharis and to daven, of course, in the evening at ma'ariv. To Amar Rabbi Yeshua ben Levi livnei, said Rabbi Yeshua ben Levi to his sons, Kadimu v'chashiku v'aylu lebeknishta, go early in the morning and then go later in the evening, in other words, to the shul, lebeknishta, and go into the shul. Kihechi de torchu chaye, in order that your days will be lengthened. This is what Rabbi Yeshua ben Levi taught his sons. If you want longevity, you want to live a long life, go to shul for shachris, go to shul for ma'ariv. Be around the shul whenever you can. Omar Rabbi Acha ben Rabbi Chanina, said Rabbi Acha, the son of Rabbi Chanina, Chanina, my kara, what is the verse that teaches us that if we go to shul for the morning and the evening, that indeed we're going to have a long life. Ashrei adam shomea li lishkod al dal tosai yom yom nishmor mezuzos pesachai. Happy is the person that listens to me, that he's constantly by my doors every single day to guard the mezuzot of my openings, to guard the doorposts of my openings. Ukasiv basrei, and it's written immediately afterwards about the person who's happy that he's going to be around the shul and he's going to be watching and protecting the shul, etc. It says immediately afterwards, Ki motzi matza chayim, because one who finds me has found life. Where do we find God? We find God in the shul. If we go to shul and we're davening, that's where God is. That's where life is. Life is God. God is life. If we're following those mitzvot, we are cleaving to the very source of life. Omar Rav Chisda said, Lo'olam, always, Ikanes Adam Shnei Petachim, the Beit HaKnesset. A person should enter into a shul the distance of, or whatever we understand by this in a moment, we'll see, two doorways. When a person comes to shul, he should not just sit down as he walks into the shul, but rather he should walk in a distance of what's called two doorways. Shnei psachim salke taitach, two doors? Is that what you think? Ela, but rather, Ema, say, shi'ur shnei ptachim. Doesn't mean to say literally that you walk through two doors, but it means to say the measurement of two doors. V'achakach itpalel, and afterwards daven. What exactly is Rav Chisda teaching us? Rav Chisda is teaching us a number of lessons here with regards to going to daven in a shul. Well, one lesson that we're going to see in a moment, we're going to read the note together, we're going to see what it's about, but it's quite straightforward if we think about it. When we go to daven in a shul, we should not make out as if the shul is a burden to us. What type of people show that they are burdened by an activity of going somewhere where they have to sit down? The person who sits closest to the entrance of the place. How come? Because the moment the whatever the thing is finishes in that particular place, he's right by the door, which means he can exit quickly. He can be the first person to leave. So Rav Chisda says, when you enter into the shul, leave some distance. Don't sit right next to the door, because by sitting right next to the door, it's as if one is saying, I can't wait till this ends, so that as soon as it ends, I'll be able to make a quick exit and get out of here as fast as possible. Another understanding that we could say, of course, is that we should enter the distance that it would, that it would take us to walk through what would be called two doors. Again, we're going to see in a minute, what does that mean exactly? How long would it take to walk that? Let's say it takes 3 seconds or 4 seconds. Don't sit down as you walk into the shul. When one walks into the shul, one should wait a few moments. Walk into the shul, relax, and then take a seat. One shouldn't kind of just, as he gets into shul, boom, he sits down, just like that. Walk in a certain period of time, relax, sit down, and prepare yourself for the davening that is about to take place. Let's take a look at all these notes to see in more detail what this really means. Very difficult words of the Gemara over here. One should enter always enter two doorways into the synagogue. What does it mean, two doorways? Funnily enough, it's interesting to note that many shuls today actually have two doorways. Well, because when one enters, one has to first enter through a main doorway to enter the actual shul perimeter. And then only afterwards, one goes to the actual shul itself where there are other doors. So to speak, in any case, one enters through two doorways. Usually a shul is not just one doorway that one opens up and immediately goes into the shul, but there's usually an outer perimeter that one has to enter first, which is one doorway. And then, of course, there's another doorway. Perhaps there are meanings behind this, perhaps ideas of honor and things like that, that it is only honorable that as we're entering the palace, we should enter through a couple of entrances to show our honor towards the place that we are going into. Obviously, the more honored the place is, the more entrances there will be before one gets to the main room where one wants to enter. One must enter a synagogue a distance equal to two doorways and only then pray. In order to satisfy the demands of all the various explanations of this halakha, one must make an effort to both enter more than 8 hand breadths, which is equivalent to the minimum width of two doorways, into the synagogue and wait an interval equivalent to the time it would take to traverse 8 hand breadths before beginning to pray. It is preferable that those who have a permanent seat adjacent to the door, and therefore there is no suspicion that they intend to leave immediately, should see to it that the door remains closed, so that they will not be distracted from their prayer by that which is transpiring outside. And that's the halacha lemaaseh as we see brought down over there in the Rambam and the Shulchan Aruch. The notes tell us a person should always enter two doorways into the synagogue. No consensus exists with regard to the explanation of this Gemara or the reasoning behind it. The Tur, based on the Jerusalem Talmud, holds that synagogues should be constructed in a manner that one must pass through two doors before arriving in the sanctuary. Based on this interpretation, it has become customary to build vestibules at the front of synagogues. From the Gemara, however, it would appear that one must take care to stand at a distance of two doorways. Though there's a disagreement as to how this is to be interpreted, some say that two doorways refers to a particular distance that one must enter so as to remove himself from the street to avoid the appearance that he is preparing to leave or to avoid being distracted from his prayers. Others maintain that one must wait a period of time sufficient to enter two doorways in order to compose himself for a moment before prayer. And if we look at this diagram on the bottom, which has been beautifully presented here, we won't find this in many other editions of the Talmud, of course. We see it's so beautifully brought down over here to give us a feeling of what it was like in those days over here to understand what the Gemara is talking about. Here we see a picture of the structure of the synagogue in Beit Alpha. This is how it used to look. This is what a synagogue used to look like. As explained in the Jerusalem Talmud, synagogues were constructed with two entrances before the sanctuary. We see here A and B. There were two entrances before. So you could imagine that there were people that would come through the shul, and they might be in the background over here, right at the very, very back, instead of being in the front of the shul, and they would hang around over here, and they would dive in, and they make a quick exit. Well, this is not correct. One should make sure to go through those two doorways, enter into the main vestibule of the shul, and to pray over there. One shouldn't be in any hurry to leave the shul, and one should therefore get into the shul as much as possible to show how much one really wants to be a part of that shul. Let us continue. Al zois yispalel kol chasid eilecha le'eis mitzoh. A verse quoted in the book of Tehillim in Psalms about this. A person should, every chassid, a pious person, should pray to you at the time of mitzvah. Le'et mitzvah, at a time of mitzvah. What does that mean exactly? Translated here as a time of finding. What does it mean to daven to God at a time of finding? Omar Rabbi Hanina, Rabbi Hanina said, le'et mitzvah, a time of finding that you need to pray about. Zo isha, this refers to a wife. What does it mean? It means a person must pray to find a wife. A person needs to get married, man needs to get married. It's not sufficient that he should just wait for his wife to come along, but he should pray for his wife. Of course, a woman should pray for her husband also. It's not much different. But since it's the way of the man to pursue, it's the way of the one who has lost the object to pursue after the lost object. And in this case, the lost object is the woman, is his wife, because as the teaching goes, that Chava was taken from the side or from the rib of Adam HaRishon, of the first man, and then she was created into this image of a woman from this rib or from the side of Adam. Nevertheless, something was taken away from Adam in order to create Chava. So too, when the idea is that in every time that a person is a male in this world, he has lost something that belongs to him. That is his wife. It's the other part of him. Either it's the rib, in inverted commas, so to speak, the lost object, or it's the other side of his existence. Whatever we want to refer to it as, we can think of many ideas. The main thing to know is he's lost something and he needs to pursue it. And it's the way of the one who has lost to search for the lost object. It is not the way of the lost object to search out for its owner or the one who lost the object. So therefore, in order to make the situation realistic, the man should pray to find a wife. He shouldn't just wait for her to appear. He should pray to God, please help me to find the missing object of my life. And I don't mean to say it in the sense of objectifying a woman, but rather I mean to say it in the sense of that there is another part that is this man, a part of him, and he has lost this part of him, and he needs to go ahead and to find where is this part, this missing part that is a part of him. So it says over here, le'et mitzor zo isha, this is referring to a woman or his wife. Shene'emar, as the verse says, matza isha, you see the same word over here, he, one who has found a woman, matza tov, which means he found a wife, he has found goodness. If a man gets married, and he finds a woman compatible with him, of course, and that he feels he's going to get along with well in his life, he shouldn't just get married because he meets a woman on the street and he says, well, I've got to get married, I'll just marry this lady over here. But rather, he should, of course, pray to God that he should find a woman who is suitable for him, and he should move ahead and get married, because if he does so, when he finds this woman, he will find good and he will have a wonderful life. The Ma'arava, in the West, ki nasev enash itita, when a man would marry a woman, omri le hachi, they would say to this fellow who was getting married, the following. Matza or motzei? He found or he is finding? What does that mean? Matza, what do they mean when they say matza, he found? Diksev, because the verse is, matza isha, matza tov. One who found a wife, he has found good. V'yapek ratzon me'ashim. And he brings, and he obtains divine favor from Hashem. And when a man gets married, he's met the right person, not only is it something good that's going to be in his life, but he even obtains favor in the eyes of Hashem. Now that he's married, now that he's complete, now that he'll be able to start a family, Bezrat Hashem, and so on and so forth, he acquires, he obtains this divine favor from Hashem. Motzei, however, what does it mean? He is finding Diksev, because it's written, O moite ani mar mi mavet, and I'm finding a bitterness that is more so bitter than death. Eta isha, this woman. Yeah, we're talking about Shlomo HaMelech. He's quoting, he's saying a particular verse, and he wants to say that it can also be, unfortunately, that if a person didn't go about things the right way, or life didn't quite work out exactly as he had wanted it to be, then he could also find a woman who is not really his soulmate, and who is always going to argue, be angry, and shout back at him, and so on and so forth, in which case things can be a lot worse for him after he gets married. And therefore, somebody who finds such a woman, he finds a bitterness in his life. It is more bitter than death. It's a real terror in his life. Every single day of his life is a terror. This woman is shouting at him and criticizing him, never got anything nice to say, never backs him up, and doesn't act towards him as a soulmate should. So in the West, which means in Eretz Yisrael, they used to have the saying, a person would get married and they go up and they'd say to him, Matza o motzei, you know, which one is it? Did you find the special lady, or is this going to be the lady who's going to make your life more bitter than death? Well, it's an interesting idea, and I guess we could speak about this concept for many, many hours as to the idea of finding the right person to get married to. And in the event that one does, one can have a very beautiful life, a very meaningful life, a life filled with a lot of growth to it. And if one doesn't find that, one's entire life can be filled with real tragedy and bitterness and hardship. The importance, therefore, of finding the right person to marry, getting the right advice, and then moving ahead and doing everything that one can to establish one's Bayit Ne'eman b'Yisrael, a faithful home in the Jewish people, a binyan adei ad, a binyan that goes on forever and ever and is a successful building that builds up the Jewish people. Rabbi Nassan Omer, Rabbi Nassan, he said something else. He says another teaching. La'etz mitzor. Remember we said at a time of finding. Well, what does it mean that we should pray at a time of finding? Before we learned, a time of finding refers to getting married, that a man should pray that he should find a special lady to marry. But Rabbi Nassan says that the time for the davening, la'etz mitzor, what does it mean that a person should daven? Zor Torah. It refers to the Torah. A person should daven that he should be successful in his Torah study. Indeed, it is not sufficient just to open up a book and to read and expect to understand everything that's going on, but rather a person should pray to Hashem, please Hashem, help me to understand your Torah. This is called le'es mitzor. Daven at a time of finding, meaning at the time when a person needs to study Torah, when he needs to learn. Hashem, help me. Shene'emar, as the pasuk says, ki motzi matza chayim. Because one who finds me has found life. And what is me? That refers to the Torah. So therefore, if one, when one wants to acquire the Torah, one should pray to Hashem, help me to find you. Help me to find you as the Torah so that I'll be successful. Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak Omar. Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak, the son of Yitzchak, he said that this term over here, la'etz mitzor, at a time of finding, refers to zomita, death. Which means what? Even when it comes to dying, a person must pray to God about the manner of death that he is going to go through. In other words, of course, this Gemara is teaching us some very powerful thoughts. And that is, first and foremost, that we must remember that prayer is something that we do for everything in our lives. We need to get married, we pray. We need to study Torah, we pray. We're going to die, everybody's going to die, we pray. We pray about the way that we're going to die. Isn't that amazing? We pray about everything in our lives. There is not a thing in this world that we should not be praying for. Even when we're well, we pray to God not to get sick. In everything in our lives, keep praying to God to help us along until ultimately we leave this world and fulfill our particular role in whatever it is that God has placed us in this world to do. So how do we know that we must pray to God about death? What must I pray to God about death? What, I shouldn't die? Everybody's going to die. What am I praying about? Because the pasuk says, "Lamaves totzaot," to death or issues of death. Lamaves totzaot. Or there are things that come out with regards to this death. Issues of death. We see the word mitzor, and we see the word totzaot. We see a relationship, a connection between these two words, which teaches us we should pray about something with regards to death. What does that mean? So he said over here, we continue. Tanya Namihachi, it was also taught in a Braisa, meaning on the same subject of death. There were 903 types of death that have been created in the world. There are 903 ways that a person can die in this world. Take a look around and everybody can see that people die in different ways. Nobody knows how they're going to die. Very interesting. We know that some people die very tragically. And some people tend to die a little bit more relaxed, in a bit more of a normal frame of mind, where the death can come in a way that a person is prepared for it. They know what's about to happen. Everybody dies differently. Why do we die this way? That's a subject for another shiur altogether. Why do we all die so differently? If God has decreed death in the world, why can't we all die in the same way? Most of us think that death will always come to us in a way of our sleep. That when we're sleeping, then God will take us away from the world. That's called death. But we see that death comes in numerous ways. Shene'emar, so he says that there are 903 different types of deaths in the world. Shene'emar, how do we know that? Because the verse says, Lamaves totzaot, to issues of death, or to death, there are totzaot. Totzaot, the word totzaot, the gematria hachi havu. It has this very gematria. What is gematria? Well, the first thing is we're going to read over here on the side under the language that gematria, the word derives from the Greek, and then he's writing over here what the Greek word is, which is, of course, geometry. Take a look at the word. Gematria, geometry. It's almost the same word, which means measurement or calculation in general. Even though it was later designated for a specific type of calculation, in rabbinic literature, it also refers to mathematical calculations in general, although it was designated for tabulating the numerical values of the letters. There's also another way of understanding the word gematria, is that gematria is also the idea of gimel, the third letter of the alphabet, and tria, which is three, as everybody can hear. Gimel, tria. Gimel is three, because you have aleph, beit, gimel. Aleph is one. Beit is two, the second letter. Gimel is three, the third letter. So the gematria is referring to the idea of the numerical value of each letter in the aleph base. Aleph is one, base is two, gimel is three, yud is 10, chaf is 20, lamed is 30. Then we get to kuf, which is then 100, resh is 200, and so on and so forth. We can calculate any number using all the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Now, we say over here, that if you take the gematria, the numerical value of this word totzaot, which is taf 400 plus vav is 6 plus tzadi, which is 90, aleph, which is 1, vav, which is 6, and another taf, which is 400, we come to the total amount of 903. So we see that with regards to death, there are 903 ways in which a death can occur. The Gemara continues to teach us more about these ways of death. Kasha shebukulan. The worst type of death that a person can have is called askara, which is called in English croup, a type of a disease related to the stomach or digestion, or whatever we're going to define it as exactly. I'm not 100% certain. We'll see in more detail as we go along. But this type of a death, which is called askara, is the hardest type of death. It's the most painful. according to the Gemara. Nicha shebukulam, the lightest type of death that a person can experience. We're all going to experience death. But the lightest type of death is called nishika, which means kissing, which means God kisses us. When does he kiss us? He kisses us when we're sleeping. While we're asleep, the divine presence literally comes to us and gives us a kiss, so to speak, on the lips. And as that kiss happens, it is so beautiful that the soul simply expires in divine ecstasy in its sleeping state, and it leaves the world. This, of course, is the most beautiful and the best type of death. And as we learned above, a person should pray to God, please God, when I die, when it's my time, whenever that is, could be today, could be tomorrow, could be in 50 years, I'm not quite sure when that's going to happen. But when I die, please let it be the most beautiful type of death, because I am going to die. I don't want a frightening death. I don't want a scary death. I want a death whereby I expire into the divine presence, into the ecstasy, and the most beautiful way of expiring this world. Askara. Askara, what is this? Damya. This type of a death called the askara, whatever we call it, is comparable to kechizra bigavava, to a thorn, bigavava de amra, which is in a yarn of wool. If you take a thorn and you put the thorn into a yarn of wool, de la achore nashra, and then you pull the thorn backwards out of the yarn of wool. Ooh, wow. This is going to create a terrible tightening, and it's going to pull hard, and it's going to ultimately yank all this wool with it. And to get this thorn out of there is really going to be a big job. What a mess. The Ikada Amri. And some people say that when we speak about this askara, it is like kafiture b'fi veshit. It is like ropes in the at the entrance of the esophagus. Or as we're going to see in a moment, also from the words pitriot in Hebrew, piturei over here in Aramaic, refers to mushrooms. And what we refer to over here, as we're going to see in the notes in a moment, referring to the mushrooms in the entrance of the esophagus. So what's basically happening here, if we take the ropes, we're going to see exactly what that is. The ropes in the esophagus. Well, what does that mean? Ropes in the esophagus? It's quite easy to imagine. If a person were to stick a rope into the esophagus and pull this rope out of the esophagus, it would be a terrible feeling, most uncomfortable, very painful to feel this experience of getting a rope out of one's esophagus. Well, this is the worst of the type of death that a person can experience in the world. And according to the Gemara, it's called askara, it's called krup, and it refers to the idea of a terrible, painful death whereby it's almost like yanking a rope out of one's esophagus. Nishika, what is a death by kiss, the divine kiss? How does that feel like? Damya, it is similar. Kemishkal binisa mechilba. It is like pulling out a hair from milk. Everybody take a hair, put hair in milk, and then put your fingers onto the hair, if you can grab it, and pull it out the milk. Comes out quite easily, no problem. And that's basically what it feels like. When the soul exits the body, it exits in a way like taking the hair out of milk. It's just a simple process of pulling it out. Nothing, it doesn't get affected by the milk. It's not getting pulled down by the milk, and so on and so forth. Whereas the idea of the mushroom, as we're going to see, or the ropes, is that when one yanks the rope out of the esophagus, it creates tremendous pain. Let us take a look here at the background, the ropes, piturei. There are numerous explanations of this term. Some of the Ge'onim explained that it refers to ropes placed through holes on a ship that pass through with great difficulty. So everybody knows that many times we have these ships that have on the sides of the ship ropes, and it's the ropes that are pulled through these holes, which are then pulled towards the dock in order to secure the ship towards the dock. So you have these ropes, and the ropes, of course, have to be pulled through with great difficulty because they have to hold the ship in place on the docks, so at the port. So therefore, it can create a great amount of friction, and it's not so easy to do for the sake, of course, of the ship, to make everything stick nicely so that it's going to be in its position. That is the feeling experienced by one suffering from croup. Another Gaonic interpretation explains that it derives from the Aramaic for mushrooms. Croup feels like a person attempting to swallow a mushroom whole. It gets stuck in his esophagus and strangles him. So let's just imagine that for a second of what it feels like having a mushroom stuck in one's throat and then trying to yank this, get this, it's all very uncomfortable, get rid of this mushroom that is sitting in the esophagus. Well, this is what it feels like for a person experiencing this particular type of death. It's so painful and it lasts so long. It's like, it's as if it's just not stopping. When is it going to end already? However, the person who experiences death as a nishika is a very simple process. It's like just holding a hair and pulling it out of milk. It's as simple as that. No pain, no difficulty. It's a very beautiful process. Rabbi Hanina Omar, Rabbi Yochanan Omar, Rabbi Yochanan said, Leis Mitzor. We continue with the description of the different types of interpretation of this expression, La'et Mitzor, at a time of finding. What does it mean that a person should pray at a time of finding? Zokavura. Never mind death. A person should pray with regards to his burial. Who thought about such a thing before? How many of us ever daven with regards to our lives after we're going to leave this world? Never mind how we're davening. Please God, let it be that when I die a painless death, like pulling out the hair through the milk. But more than that, how many people pray for the way that they're going to be buried? We have to pray for the way we're going to be buried. If we don't, we don't know where we're going to end up, right? Once the person dies and the body's left on its own, there's no talking, there's no discussion. We're left in the hands of everybody else who's going to take care of us, and we don't know what they're going to do to us. Omar Rabbi Hanina, Rabbi Hanina said, my kara, what is the verse? Meaning, if you're going to tell me about davening for burial, which verse from the Torah is going to point us to this idea that we have to pray with regards to our burial? The verse is, Hasmeichim eli gil yasisu ki yimtzu ukaver, who rejoice in exaltation and are glad when they can find a grave. So there's a gladness in finding a grave. One should be happy when one can find a grave. One should pray to be happy in the opportunity that the body is going to be buried. It's going to bring a certain sense of nachas, a certain sense of satisfied with regards to one's body resting where it should be. As there are situations in which one is relieved when his body finds a grave in which to rest. How many of us know the story that when a person dies, God forbid, a tragic death, that they take the body and they put it into a storage area, into fridges to keep the body cold until the time of burial. It just sits there until the body is buried. This is a terrible sadness for the body because the body needs to be buried as soon as possible so that the soul can go upwards and ascend to its place, wherever it is supposed to go. But it can only start this process when it's buried. Meanwhile, it has to rest in this other fridge somewhere while people wait for an autopsy or whatever it needs to be done. Whatever extra things have to be done to check out on before we can bury this person, identifying the body and all these things, whatever takes place is really, unfortunately for the person, it's considered disrespectful and it's considered to be a very sad moment for this person because the body is not being buried. But when the body is buried, the soul takes great satisfaction. Now that the body can go to its place where it has to go to, the soul can also return to its place that it needs to return to. So we pray to God, please God, let it be that after my beautiful death, that I die the most beautiful of these 903 deaths, that also I should be buried as fast as possible and in a most dignified and honorable fashion as quickly as possible. Omar Rabba bar Rav Sheila, Rabba, the son of Rav Sheila, said, Hayinu da'amri inashe, that's what people say. Libo e inash rachame afilu ad zibula basraisa shilama. A person should ask for mercy. He should pray. Even until the last amount of earth, the complete last amount of earth is thrown upon the grave. We should be praying until our final moment of existence in this world, which is until that final amount of earth is placed upon the coffin, upon the person's body, so that ultimately he has found his place of rest His life has come full circle. He has gone from being born into this world, going through life, and experiencing all the processes of life, death, and burial. Now that he's completely buried, he will attend, he will go on to the rest of his life of the soul existence, wherever he goes to, while the people who have come to the cemetery will go home. They will leave him, and he will be on his own. He cannot wait. He can't wait enough already. While people are busy performing the entire funeral, he's still waiting around. Now everything has reached its final point. The person has been completely buried, and everything is sealed up. He's under the ground. He has returned to the place where he was supposed to be returned to, and the soul can go onwards to its place in heaven above. So a person should pray right up until that last moment. When we pray to God about all the things in our life, we need to pray to him even about our death, even about our burial, even about the final moments of when the final people who are doing the digging, that they are putting the shoveling of the dirt on top of the body, until that very final moment. Please, God, let it happen in the most honored, dignified manner. Let it happen quickly. Let it happen in a beautiful manner so that there's no disrespect and things should go according to plan. There shouldn't be any delay. Marzutra, Omar. Marzutra gives his opinion. And he said, La'is Mitzor, this idea of a time of finding, what does that refer to? That a person should pray at a time of finding. Marzutra said it refers to Zebet HaKiseh. It refers to a bathroom, the house of the chair. It refers to a bathroom. A person should pray that he has a bathroom. Omri b'ma'arava, they said in the West, Ha de Marzutra Adiva Mikulhu. This teaching of what Marzutra is saying, that one should pray to have a bathroom, a toilet close to one, in other words, is the best of all. How come? Well, anybody knows, as a human being, if a person needs the bathroom and he doesn't have access to a bathroom, it can certainly be a most uncomfortable experience. And of course, people need the bathroom on a regular basis during the day. One can only think back to these periods of time when they didn't have plumbing as we have today in modern times. And people only had this shed on the outside, maybe 100 meters from where one lived, or 200 meters away. I don't know, whatever the distance was. If a person needed the bathroom, they had to run out of their house and go and find this particular shack where there was a seat and an opening, and that's what it was. That was the plumbing of those days. And if one needed the bathroom, one had to go there to this place and use this particular place and then return back to one's home. Of course, if one needed the bathroom again 5-10 minutes later, for whatever reason, you had to make a run for it and go back to that place again. Today, with modern plumbing, today a home has one bathroom, two bathrooms. The wealthier people have 10 bathrooms in their home. As they're walking down the corridor, there's a bathroom on the right side and a bathroom on the left side. Well, Marzutra said to us that we should pray to be close to a bathroom, because this is the greatest thing. In those days, it was a great thing to have a bathroom very close to one. And in truth, it is no different today. We are lucky. We are very fortunate. We have been given a bracha, that in today's times, the dignity has returned upon us, that we have dignity in the sense that we have a toilet next to our bedrooms, and perhaps even 2 or 3 meters away from our bedrooms, or from the main room in the apartment or the house, not very far away. If one needs the bathroom and suddenly needs the bathroom again 5 minutes later, it's there, it's unoccupied, and there are two of them. If there are two people in the house or three people, there's another bathroom available if somebody else needs it. What luxury we live in today. And according to the Talmud, this request that Marzutra said, that a person should pray, El'eit Mitzor, this refers to having a bathroom very close to one. It is the greatest thing that we can have. It brings us the greatest dignity, so that we don't have to embarrass ourselves if we need to go to the bathroom. Everybody knows what that's about. And we see that Marzutra is not very far off. Therefore, a person should pray to be lucky enough to have a bathroom nearby one. We've reached the end of the shiur. I thank you very much for joining me for this shiur in Talmud Brachot. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you have, please give me the thumbs up and like this video. and to click on the subscribe button to subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. For those of you who have subscribed, I want to just say thank you very much for your subscription, and thank you for being a part of everything that we're involved in over here. Click on the bell button to be notified of future Shiurim, and feel free to contact me. I'm Eliyahu Shir. You can find my site at www.lovingkindness.co, where you can contact me via the contact form. I'm always delighted to be in touch with anybody who is in touch with me about serious things, real things, anything that you want to discuss about Torah and life. I'd be delighted to discuss with you. And of course, just come through to the site, check out what we're doing. And if you're able to, become a partner in our activities, become a member of our site, and take part in the things that we're doing. Find out more about what we're doing, because we'd like to include you as well. As you see, this Shiur was sponsored by an anonymous donor, and it was sponsored for Le'iloi Nishmas, for the memory of Hitzla Ayeles Bas Yehuda Uriah Kohen. And of course, I would be delighted to provide further shiurim for you if you help out on what we're doing on our side to sponsor some of these shiurim that we're doing here, make them so that we can make it available to people out there. We can only do it with your help. If you sponsor shiur and allow us to continue, I'd be delighted to announce the name and to put something on the bottom of the shiur, so that everybody can see that it has been sponsored either with your name or anonymously, and whose memory or whose honor you have chosen to sponsor the shiur. In the meantime, I say thank you very much for joining me, and I look forward to another shiur, and I wish you everything of the best. Shalom, shalom. Bye-bye.